What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. As preparation for system design interviews in the previous video of this series, we covered scaling and load balancing. Today we are going to go over two additional topics, databases and caching. I'm going to kick it off with databases. If you have no idea what a database is, feel free to check our database playlist linked in the card above. Now, if I want to oversimplify it, a database is responsible for the storage and retrieval of data for an application. It must be reliable, efficient, and correct. However, it turns out that doing all these things at once is complex, which led to the creation of the CAP theorem. This theorem will help us understand the trade-off at the very heart of database design. CAP stands for consistency, availability, and partition tolerance, and the theorem implies that any distributed database can only satisfy two of these three features. Now, among these three, distributed databases must choose partition tolerance, because these databases are designed to handle large volumes of data and high user loads by distributing data across multiple nodes. When the system is partitioned, each partition can continue to serve requests independently, allowing the system to scale. By choosing partition tolerance, the system can provide uninterrupted service and maintain performance even when network partitions occur. This implies a trade-off between consistency and availability. In other words, if part of the cluster goes down, the system can either satisfy consistency, so it will roll back any unfinished operations and wait to respond until all nodes are stable again, or it can satisfy availability, so it will continue responding but risk inconsistencies. A system is called a CP database if it provides consistency and partition tolerance, and an AP database if it provides availability and partition tolerance. Now that we've talked about the theoretical constraints of the CAP theorem, let's look at the fundamental unit of database operations, the transaction. A transaction is a series of database operations that are a single unit of work. The operations in a transaction either all succeed or they all fail. This is formalized in the ACID properties which we previously covered and which stand for atomicity, consistency, isolation, and durability. These properties should be satisfied no matter the type of database you are using. Speaking of types, we previously mentioned that we can either have relational or non-relational databases. I am going to dive into relational DBs because that's what our previous videos were mostly about. However, you should use relational databases when there are many relationships between entities, when data needs to follow a predetermined schema, or when relationships between data always need to be accurate. On the other hand, non-relational databases are optimized for specific use cases that need scalability, schema flexibility, or specialized query support. Non-relational databases are often called NoSQL databases because they can use other query languages. Each type is better and worse at scaling because of the features it provides. Vertical scaling is straightforward. On the other hand, horizontal scaling requires higher overall compute and storage capacity. The big drawback is that relational databases, the most popular database model, struggle to scale horizontally. Okay, we previously mentioned and just recapped when to use relational databases, but what about non-relational DBs? You see, there are many types of non-relational databases and each one can be used for a specific use case. Let's go over these. First, graph databases such as Neo4j and CosmosDB. These DBs model data with nodes and edges. They are the most like a relational data model because they are also good at representing data with lots of relationships. The main benefit of a graph database is that queries don't need to join to follow relationship edges because data isn't stored in tables, so they're well suited for queries that traverse many edges of a graph. Next are document stores such as MongoDB, Couchbase, Firebase, and DynamoDB. These are usually simple JSON objects stored with a key identifier. Documents represent a set of information related to a single topic which could be spread out over different tables in relational DBs. For example, a document store might archive other records related to a single customer so that only one document needs to be accessed at a time. Key value stores such as Redis and DynamoDB are like document store, but the data stored in the value is opaque. The key value store has no notion of what is stored in the value, so it only provides simple read, overwrite, and delete operations. There are no schemas, no joins or indices, it is a very large hash table. Key value stores are easy to scale and are particularly suitable for caching implementations. When the values need to be large, this kind of database is referred to as an object store or blob store. Column families, such as Cassandra, are a set of columns that are typically retrieved together. A column family database models data in tables like a relational database, but stores column families together in files instead of rows and doesn't enforce relational constraints. For data with strong column family access patterns, this model boosts performance by limiting how much data needs to be read. Search engine databases provide the specialized feature of full-text search over very large amounts of unstructured text data. This data can possibly come from multiple sources, meaning the results may not exactly match the search string. The top search engines databases in the industry are Elasticsearch, Splunk, and SolR. Finally, time series databases such as Prometheus are optimized for data entries that need to be strictly ordered by time. The main use case is storing real-time data streams from system monitors. Time series databases are write-heavy and usually provide services for sorting streams as they come in to make sure they are appended in the correct order. Okay, the second topic for today is caching. Caching is an important concept in system design, and it's a technique that stores copies of frequently used application data in a layer of smaller, faster memory to improve data retrieval times, throughput, and compute costs. Caching is based on the principle of locality, which means that programs repeatedly access data located close to each other. There are two kinds of locality: temporal locality, which is time-based, where data that has been referenced recently is likely to be referenced again, and spatial locality, which is space-based, where data that is stored near recently referenced data is also likely to be referenced. When a data request goes through a cache, a copy of the data is either already in the cache, which is called a cache hit, or it's not, and the data has to be fetched from a primary store and copied into the cache, which is called a cache miss. A cache performs well when there are many more cache hits than cache misses. But when should we use caching and when shouldn't we use it? You see, caching is most helpful when the data you need is slow to access, possibly because of slow hardware, having to go over the network, or complex computation. Caching is helpful in systems where there are many requests and slow to no change in data. It reduces load on primary data stores, reducing service costs with higher and more performant response times. On the other hand, caching isn't helpful when it takes just as long to access the cache as it does to access the primary data, or when requests have higher randomness, as caching performance comes from repeated memory access patterns. Also, caching isn't helpful when the data changes frequently, as the cached version gets out of sync and the primary data store must be accessed every time. Now that we know when to use and when not to use caching, let's look at different cache types, or more specifically, cache replacement policies. The cache replacement policy is an essential part of the success of a caching layer. The replacement policy, also called eviction policy, decides what memory to free when the cache is full. First, we have the LRU cache, or least recently used policy. In an LRU policy, the entry in the cache that is the oldest will be freed when the cache is full. LRU performs well and is simple to understand, so it's a good default choice of replacement policy. To implement LRU, the cache keeps track of recency with aging bits that need to be updated on every entry every time data is accessed. Although LRU makes efficient decisions about what data to remove, the computational overhead of keeping track of the aging bits leads to approximations. LRU-based algorithms are well suited for applications where the oldest data are the least likely to be used again. The second policy is the LFU, or least frequently used. In an LFU replacement policy, the entry in the cache that has been used the least frequently will be freed. Frequency is tracked with a simple access count in the entry metadata. LFU replacement policies are especially helpful for applications where infrequently accessed data is the least likely to be used again. Stay tuned for the next video of the series, in which we will cover additional basic concepts before fully diving into solving architecture and design interview questions. So, that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching. Take care, and I will see you in the next one.